This movie describes the building of a kit from Touchwood Models of England of Donald Campbell's Bluebird K7. The movie shows you something of how I built it, the modifications that were made to it, and how it ran, and also an analysis of the performance of the model, at least based on its first runs. And finally, when it stopped running, how it was actually rescued using my new rescue boat. And as you may know, originally it was a jet-powered boat. And I tried very unsuccessfully to make it work with an electrically driven fan. Many people have tried, and none of them seem to have succeeded particularly well. I'll just turn the boat round so you can see what it's like as I'm talking. And there's this in the back here is what would have been the jet efflux. Okay, so having done all that and been thoroughly obstinate, I finally gave in and went to the traditional approach that people use with a surface running prop and the rudder to one side. Let's bring it back again round to here. It's driven with a flex drive. Okay, I'll pause it right here. What we see inside here, inside the machinery spaces, are first of all a motor down there, which is a 2750 kV motor, driving a flex drive shaft out to the propeller. Very conventional. But in this case, the motor is mounted on a plate to which the propeller shaft outer tube is brazed. That means that I guarantee the alignment of the propeller shaft to the motor shaft. Most people, in fact, mount the propeller shaft assembly directly onto the hull. So if there's any fluxing of the hull, which can certainly happen, particularly with a fiberglass hull, then you lose alignment. So this guarantees continual alignment at this point. What you cannot see is down in the front here is a radar, an OSC radar 60 amp ESC. And it is water cooled. And it's a challenge to put it in there and mount it. So what I did is I made two extension pipes for the water cooling and then was able to clamp these extension pipes to the hull where I could get at them. So I can take the assembly out if I have to. This is a new AR6610T receiver from Spectrum, which is their, I would say, must be their, pretty close to their gold standard. It comes with a satellite receiver, which is here. It's really a remote receiver, which is here. I haven't stuck down yet. On the other side, what we have is an EagleTree V3 data logger. And this data logger gets signals from the temperature of the ESC. It also measures the RPM. And it also measures the location using a GPS system. So I'll turn it around so you can see the GPS system there. Here you see the GPS module that's made by EagleTree. That's the receiver there, which has to face vertically upwards in a clear unobstructed access. This looks like a candy, but it's really just a bunch of turns around a ferrite core for uses an RF choke. And that signal is also fed into the EagleTree servo. So to summarize, we have RPM, we have ESC temperature, we also have volts and amps because the V3 measures directly volts and current. And then we have finally, of course, the GPS receiver that feeds in there. Virtually all the parts for the hydroplane propulsion system came from offshore electronics in Chelsea, Massachusetts. So this you see here is a propeller, which I bought balanced and so forth, so paid extra for that. This is a conventional drive system. It's using 3/16 drive shaft. This is the rudder system. It's fairly obvious. And you can see that it has a reasonably good swing of motion. Unfortunately, the first time I took the boat out, it hit a submerged rock, which caused the rudder to bash back and broke the small breakaway brass screw that's in there. And it also managed to hit the propeller, but fortunately didn't damage it. The position of the center of gravity is very important for hydroplanes to work correctly. And so what we have to do is fit the battery and then balance it. The batteries that I used was this 3600 milliamp hour battery made by Genzes. It's actually a high voltage battery, a high voltage LiPo battery, but I don't use it to that extent. I just go to the normal LiPo voltages. So first of all, what we have to do is slide it into place. And it needs to go as far forward as possible for the balance to be reasonably good. So we'll put it there. This is the remote receiver. I'll just stick that back in there. And then when it gets plugged in, it's plugged in there like that. So the system is now plugged in and closed. And now what we're This shows balancing the center of gravity. As you can see, it's just around where the outlet for the water cooling system comes. It's about 2 inches behind the rear part of the sponson. In the full-scale model, in the full-scale boat, it's a little further forward. But this is where we're going to run with it, and it seems to be okay, as you will see later on. All right. Now I have the transmitter. It's a DX6i, an oldie but a goodie, and the beeping from the ESC has stopped. So you can see as I run the prop at the back, that seems to work fine, and this is the range of the rudder motion that I have.
Alright, now here we are at Lake Quanapowhit in Wakefield, Massachusetts. This will be a demonstration run. It quickly gets up to speed, as you can see, and it's quite a good turn of speed. Its actual maximum was nearly 44 miles an hour. What you see is it only goes fast in a straight line. It's not designed to make turns at high speed like racing hydroplanes, because it's a record-breaking boat that only has to work in a straight course. So here are some runs. Oh, it bounces a little bit, so it's close to the limit, I would say. And we start another run, and then it decides it's had enough, and it slows down after a while. So you'll see that. Whoops, there we are. Probably a temperature limitation, I would guess. With the data recorder on board, I really wanted to know how fast the boat went, how much current was being taken, what the RPM of the motor was, and also what the temperature of the ESC was. So this plot here just shows three graphs, speed, current, and RPM. And as you can see, that there's an apparent delay between the RPM and the GPS speed, and this is obviously related to data processing, etc. There's also a lag between the current and the RPM, which is due to the sampling processing on the data logger. So it looks from there, eyeballing it, about a 2.4 second delay between the actual RPM of the seen by the prop and the GPS receiver. So what I did is I ran some experiments on an Excel spreadsheet where I shifted the GPS speed to get the best possible match with the RPM, just to try and get them coincident, as it were. And I ran several runs on the Excel, so you'll see that in a minute. Here is the plot of the actual RPM and speed recorded by the GPS, time shifted by about 2.4 seconds. And you can see that it wiggles around a bit, but it's pretty consistent. It's very interesting, this graph, because I had no idea how hydroplanes really worked. You can see from the start, it runs up and then it runs at a fairly steady speed of 10 miles an hour, and then it accelerates up to about 24 miles an hour at 15,000 RPM. Then there's another slope, and then obviously the planing starts when the slope goes vertically. So that red shaded line is really my sort of eyeball guess of what's really happening. So it's a very interesting graph. And the other thing is that at the top speed that's seen on the graph here, it looks like the prop has a slip of about 15%, and that seems quite credible. On the way back down again, as it comes down, it gets down to about 14,000 RPM, and then the speed just drops away. Well, this is a surface running prop, and I have no experience of them before, but I think it's kind of an interesting graph to look at. We need to know the temperature of the ESC. I have a temperature sensor mounted on the outside of the ESC. And as you can see in this graph, the maximum temperature I saw anywhere was about 104 degrees Fahrenheit, which is really quite modest. And you could see how it raised up over the 50-minute period here. And then it dropped back again. But it's clearly very safe here. And so the water cooling system, you know, which picks up the water at the radiator and exits out of the side, seems to be working okay. It's kind of interesting on the second incident how the temperature drops down a bit, but the range is really, you know, not too much, just about a 10 degree drop at that point. So generally, I don't think I have a problem with the cooling system. Here's the final bit of data I'm going to show, which is the GPS track recorded during those runs that I made. You can see I kept it fairly close to the starting point and only made one, shall we say, courageous loop out into the middle of the lake. This is just a bit of fun. Well, after the Bluebird stopped running at one point, it was time to call in the rescue boat that I had made, and you can see that in another YouTube video. You can see it's kind of neat, and it's able to steer the boat around. You have to make sure that the vessel is pretty much lined up with the rescue boat, because otherwise it doesn't steer properly. But this seems to be working all right. Well, we hit the rudder, hit the ground at that point, and but you can see that it can maneuver quite well. So I was quite pleased with that. There you can see the rudder at the angle as it swings around and brings it into the dock, where it comes in, parks the boat, backs off, and then comes into itself to the rest. So we go there, we back up, move it around, and that does the job. Just to wrap things up, this is a list of the parts that we used to build this model. I hope it's all been rather interesting for you, and thank you for sticking with me to the end of this rather long presentation.